Right, before getting onto the insert guitar effect, there's a few things to mop up in mixer mode. And I've tried to address some of these by adding captions on the videos after publishing them, but it's better to explain them properly. So this is a bit of a hodgepodge of topics. I was talking about track faders last time, and I may have given the impression that all levels are saved and restored. And this is certainly true for send and return levels and the input levels, which we saw here. But the track fader levels are not saved and not restored. The digital trim levels are, but not the faders. So when you load a song, the main track levels are always reset to wherever these physical faders happen to be. In addition, the mute states are saved, but not the solo states or fader groups, or even the record arm status. Anyway, I think all the other settings are saved. Here's the machine in its reset state, and you can see all the levels and the EQ, everything's off or set to zero. Digital trim set to zero. All the faders are down. Inputs, again, everything's zero. That's what a clean slate means to me. Now let's load a song I prepared earlier. Let's go back to the mixer. And you'll see input A has got phase and insert effect. Its level has been restored to the saved value. Master levels have been reset. Various EQ settings. Back to the tracks. And again, EQ, send levels, master levels, digital trim. But the fader level has not been restored. I did have them set partway up. Okay, another point with track faders. I mentioned that you can only route a maximum of 8 input signals through the track paths. You can only select 8 of these. So you might ask, well, what's the point of all these other faders? Well, these are all for playing back recorded tracks. And all 16 or 20 faders, depending on your machine, they all can be used during playback. And we'll get to this later. A quick mention of the sends. And send 1 and send 2 are both mono signals. So what do you do if you need a stereo send? Say if your external effects unit needs a stereo input. Well, you can use send 1 for the left channel and send 2 for the right. And you'll find lots of other mixers have an even number of sends for this reason. I'll leave the details for later when I look at stereo signals. I just wanted to mention that it's possible. Another point I missed was that you don't need anything connected to the send sockets in order to check the send 1 or send 2 levels. You can use the monitor system. And just press monitor select and select either send 1 or send 2. I've got track 1 going to send 1 and send 2. See here, both post fader sends, both masters up full, but send 2 is lower than send 1. So we're monitoring send 1, and now we're monitoring send 2. And the master stereo, there's nothing coming out because the stereo level is not up. There it is. Now this is not looking directly at the send bus. It monitors the signals after the master level controls. So it really shows you what is going out of the machine on the send sockets and what is going to the internal send effect. And this is just like the monitor stereo position, where it shows exactly what is going out of the machine on the stereo output sockets, which is why this fader affects it. So you can think of the monitor system as a kind of probe for checking signals at various points. So it's worth getting to know. And because whatever you're monitoring appears on these meters, you've got a handy overload indicator at the top of the bars. Just note that if you're using both sends to make a stereo send, you won't hear this stereo effect in the monitor. As you can see from this monitor select, you can only monitor one or the other at any one time. So each mono send, like the left or the right side, is split equally across the left and right channels in the monitor. And you can tell from the meters, in fact, because left and right both stay in step, the signal is actually a mono signal in the centre of your stereo field. I promised an example of phase way back in the series, so now's a chance to cover this. In this example mix, I've got two microphones.
Mocking, it is savage yet sublime.
Both picking up the same vocals and guitar. So this is a classic case where you could get phasing problems. So let's invert the phase on one of the inputs and see if it makes a difference.
But I cannot just look back on what has gone before. My life would ebb away, precious seconds every day. I can't do this anymore.
On the subject of phase, let's just try an experiment. You probably all know that if you add two signals which are exactly the same but out of phase, they should cancel each other out, and any slight imbalance in the signals will prevent a total cancellation. So we can use this to see how well matched the two paths are through this machine. I've set the assign up here for my guitar track, which is coming in on input A. I routed it to track one. And straight through to the stereo bus. Now track one will go through to the stereo bus as well. And both signals will be mixed together. Right, here's both signals. Okay, what if we invert the phase in the input path? Go to the mixer, input A. Phase inverted. No effect. So well done if you said no change, because that was a trick question. If you look on the diagram, the input phase control comes before the point where we split the signal. So both paths will be inverted and there'll be no cancellation. So what happens if I invert the phase on the track path? Select track. There's the phase for the track. Inverted. Not inverted. That's up full now. Now any slight imbalance will upset this cancellation, so let's try altering the level on the track path. I've just gone down a smidge, less than a dB, and you can hear something. If I go higher, that's the zero where it's level, that's higher. Now try the EQ. There's no point doing the input EQ because that's affecting both paths. Let's try the track EQ. Now this might all seem a bit frivolous, but exploring like this gives you more insight and confidence in using the machine. And now we've noticed that there are two EQs in series if we route an input to a track. So is that of any use? Well, a typical use for EQ is to first top and tail the signal to get rid of any unwanted clutter, say a high pass filter for getting rid of traffic rumbles, air conditioning, and there's all sorts, foot tapping, microphone proximity effects, and a low pass filter for removing unwanted harmonics, say. So that's two bands out of the three already spoken for. On this machine we've only got three bands, high, mid and low. So if you now want to sweeten the signal by adding some air or getting rid of any resonances in somebody's voice, you're running out of bands. So having two EQs could be quite useful because you've then got six bands to play with.